It's crab season on Alaska's Bering Sea. A handful of adventurers will battle Arctic weather, rogue waves, and deadly steel.
Get away from the pond! Get away! Hold
on. For the chance at big money in this modern-day gold rush. On average, the Bering Sea will claim one unlucky soul every week of the season, making Alaskan crab fishing the deadliest job on earth. The season is only hours old, but for the 84-foot Raven, her luck has already run out.
We're laying way over on our side. Five people on the boat. Repeat, five people.
Hanging like a string of pearls between Russia and Alaska, the Aleutian Islands cut deep into the most violent waters on Earth. One of the few sanctuaries in the Aleutians is Dutch Harbor, home to the world's largest crab fleet. Every October, men from all over the world descend on Dutch Harbor for one thing, the chance to earn more money than the average person does in a year in just 5 days on a Bering Sea crab boat.
See what happens. Maybe I'll like it, maybe I'll hate it, but the money definitely drew me in.
But with so much cash to be made, it's often too easy to ignore the dangers of crab fishing.
I'm always up for traveling and taking risks.
I've never been on a boat before. I've never been fishing at all. So it'll definitely be a new experience and something I'm somewhat looking forward to check it out.
Most jobs are filled months ahead of time, but some hopefuls have traveled thousands of miles for the chance of scoring a last minute job.
I haven't been to Dutch for 2 years. A couple years ago, I got my hand sucked up on a winch and it pretty much tore it off except for the tendons. And fortunately, the doctor did a good job in rebuilding it. I lost my finger, but then again, I saved it. You know, I have my lucky charm right here. That's my lucky charm. This is gonna be such a good season. The average per boat's probably be about 70,000 pounds. So I don't know where else in the country a guy can make anywhere from 20 to 100,000 bucks in 5 days legally. I'm trying to get on with my brother's boat, the Constellation. In the event that that doesn't happen, I've got a couple guys that owe me a favor. I'll probably take him out drinking, duct tape him in my room, and I'll show up for the boat just when it's about to leave. Sometimes it's hard to get a job. You got to do what you got to do.
While the competition is fierce on land, it will be a war on water. 252 boats will spread out over hundreds of square miles. Each boat will haul as much crab as possible until a 14 million pound quota is met. The Erla N is one of the fleet's top money makers and is skippered by one of the fleet's toughest captains, Bing Hinkle.
There's one guy in charge on a crab vessel, and that's the guy driving that boat. It's got to be that way.
Bing will compete against fourth-generation fisherman Sig Hansen, captain of the 126-foot Northwestern.
Fishing's always been in our family. Family stems from Norway, and they were all fishermen, so it's just one of those things that it's just a part of you.
Competing against these bigger boats, the 104-foot Sea Star, captained by Larry Hendricks, is small in size, but big in heart.
I've managed to fish the last 42 seasons. king crab, so I have quite a bit of experience with it.
While crab fishing is usually a young man's game, the Sea Star's crew is one of the oldest in the fleet.
On this boat, I have a couple old-timers that have been with me for 25 years. They're just known as the geriatric crew.
Some guys are gonna do better, and we will, I know, and others are not gonna do so good. So it's kind of like you versus a crab, but you versus everybody else too, as far as poundage. That's the name of the game. Bottom line is poundage.
Large hauls mean big money for the deckhands, since their pay is calculated as a percentage of the catch. But even on a top boat like the Erla N, there are no guarantees.
That's why it's called fishing. You might go out and not make a dime. Or you might go out and kill them. I mean, work 3 months out of the year and make $140,000. I mean, that's what it's about.
On the night before departure, the fleet is going over final preparations, tying down 800-pound crab pots stacked high on deck and loading tons of frozen bait. With his crew occupied, Larry Hendricks goes for a last-minute shopping spree.
The reason I'm here is to keep the crew from buying too much junk food. We won't eat meat and chimichangas for breakfast.
I've been cooking on boats for the last 20 years, you know, off and on. You cook one way, you know, at home, but when you're cooking on a boat, it makes it a little harder because the boat's rocking and rolling and moving around. You have to learn to cook if you want to eat, and I like to eat.
Caffeine, this is a critical decision. I can't run out. We have actually made trips 10, 20 miles across the ocean to keep the crew from getting cranky when they run out of coffee. It's a major staple in these men's lives. Have a little bit of everything just in case we run out of something. It's not like you can run to the grocery store and you're in the middle of the ocean.
For their last night in Dutch Harbor, the crews gather at the notorious Elbow Room Bar for the traditional send-off. As the drinks flow,
cheers.
The survival stories start to come out.
I've been crab fishing 13 years, and I was on the Lucian Enterprise at sank in 1990. It's like you fall off your bicycle, you get back up on it, right?
These stories are grim reminders that disaster strikes often amongst this high seas family, and that tonight may be the last time these men ever share a drink together. It's October 14th. Departure day, and the crew of the Erla N is up at sunrise.
How's it going?
Good morning.
And their rookie crew member, Levi Dow, is waking up to the reality of living on a crab boat.
I call it the coffin bunk. Just wide enough to get in, but not wide enough to do any rolling around.
I'm a greenhorn to this fishery up here in the Bering Sea because I've actually never come up here and worked with these kind of pods before. As a greenhorn, you gotta work a lot harder to press these guys that you're working with that have been doing it for 15, 18 years, you know, to show them that I'm worthy of, you know, being on the boat.
This is a pretty hardcore boat, man. I mean, anytime we hire someone on the Erla N, I paint the blackest picture I can possibly paint. You know, just evil slave ship. I don't want the guy coming on here to know we work, always.
Levi will have his work cut out for him, impressing one of the fleet's toughest skippers.
Right now I'm going over the list of priorities. Number one, pots. Number two, the bait that goes in the pots to catch the crab. And then the last one, the crew. Is everybody on the boat? Answer my question. Is everybody on the boat?
Yes, everybody's on the boat.
Except for Roberto and Sam.
What are you talking about? They're not on the boat then, are they?
No, Sam.
You better get them. This engine started?
Bing's a real tough guy to work for. There's no question about it. As long as you don't take things personally, you're fine.
At 10 a.m., the fleet is cleared to depart by the U.S. Fish and Game Service for their 20-hour journey to the fishing grounds in eastern Bristol Bay. Once again, the world's last gold rush has begun.
Let the games begin.
For the newer members of the Sea Star, each one has his own reason for starting this dangerous journey.
I made a couple bad choices in my life. Did some jail time. After the jail sentence was up, I was pretty much stuck in a rut. I didn't know what to do, didn't have any real job opportunities because of the jail. You know, it's hard to find good work. I had an opportunity to get my life together. I was tired of being sick and tired.
I didn't come up here really for the money. I mean, the money was half of it, but the other half was, man, I'm gonna go do something that hardly anybody else ever does, you know? It's tough.
Whether seeking money, adventure, or a second chance, the statistics remain the same. The odds are one man from the fleet won't be returning from this king crab season alive. At 10 a.m. on October 14th, the Bering Sea Crab Fleet left Dutch Harbor for the fishing grounds in eastern Bristol Bay. But early next morning, the Sea Star limps back into Dutch Harbor. She has barely survived a worst-case scenario, sinking at night on the Bering Sea.
Well, we just woke up with a red light on the board, which means there's a problem somewhere. So we went back to the Lazarette and it's full of water. There was a safety alarm that failed to go off for some reason.
Essentially, we started rolling along on the idea we were going to save the boat. I mean, yeah. We definitely didn't want to lose the boat. These men have worked on it all summer long to bring it back into a grand old gal situation, and then to watch all that hard work go. They were just as determined as I was to make sure we had the season.
For me, anyway, I've never experienced anything like that. But, you know, I trust in the Lord to take care of me, so.
There you go.
I really, deep down, I knew it was all going to be good, you know.
There must have been about 6-7 feet of water back there. We took about 8-10 hours of pumping to pump it out because there was a leak. There was a 2-inch pipe that apparently busted or something down there. The deck boards came up back there. It was just wishy-washy back and forth, and it was close. We're lucky to be here.
Oh, yeah, when we opened up the hatch, the water was up above this ladder, this stuff right here. About 3,000 gallons, I guess.
Crap happens, you know, it goes into that category kind of, and you deal with it as you can, you know. Luckily we didn't lose the boat.
We had no choice other than to come on in. I had no steering other than by hand, so we steered in by hand, and now we're just trying to get fixed up, get the essentials going, and we're going fishing. We'll just be a few pots short, but sometimes you have to adapt and improvise and play a different game. The end result is we managed to save the boat, but it's one of the scariest events that you can happen on the boat.
Like Michael Jordan says, you know, you gotta get your game face on, so that's what we're doing, you know, basically.
The Sea Star is already behind in a game that has little room for error. With such a short season, the crew's luck will need to turn around drastically if they're going to come out ahead. The start of king crab season on Alaska's Bering Sea is only hours away. The crab fleet has arrived in eastern Bristol Bay, where they have spread out over hundreds of square miles in search of the best fishing spots.
Okay, at this time, before each trip, we do a safety meeting. Let's start with a distress broadcast. If everybody on the boat disappeared and you were the only one on the boat to do that, basically you just say, go on one of the emergency channels and say three times, Mayday, Mayday, Mayday. This is the Erla N, Erla N, Erla N. And then if you can, try to get a position. If somebody goes over, you keep your eye on them, foot's on the horn, Brendan. Once again, if something... No, I'm not... You guys listen to me, and I ain't... Or I'm going to start getting hot here. You guys listen up. If somebody goes over, I want that guy back. You're going to... You guys know what you have to do and do it, so plan on doing it. I don't want to lose anybody on this trip. You got that? I don't want to have to get to this point, but I will. So let's go on with our safety meeting. First of all, we're going to have somebody get into a survival suit. And Levi, have you been in one before?
Yeah.
Well, you get to do it again. And this is for everybody. So why don't you grab one? I'll time you to see what you can do it in, but you're required to do it in a minute and a half. From the minute you open it until you got on ready to jump in the water. Going down, going down, going down.
Baseball hat.
Now you're gonna have to do it again.
The freezing waters of the Bering Sea can kill a man in minutes. But encased in these buoyant neoprene suits, men can survive for hours in the freezing water. Hundreds of miles out at sea, their fate then usually rests in the hands of the U.S. Coast Guard, stationed in the remote outpost of Cold Bay, Alaska.
Our ways around the nooks and crannies real good, so we feel
the elite search and rescue team based here is going over final checklists to prepare for the season opening.
I'm pretty excited. It's kind of scary. It feels like you're just waiting for something to happen. You're hoping nothing does.
If you come in Coast Guard to do search and rescue, this place is where it happens. I think a lot of guys would like to get up here, at least for some portion of their career. It's a blast.
The Coast Guard's weapon of choice for responding to emergencies on the Bering Sea is their $15 million rescue chopper.
We're going to be heading out to the fishing fleet. We're going to be observing them, make sure everybody, you know, kind of find the boundaries of the fleet, where they are. On top of that, just to kind of show the Coast Guard presence out there. You know, we go out, show the fishermen that we are indeed out here.
Knowing that this is a 4 to 5 day fishery, we've tasked our Coast Guard cutter to reposition from its patrol in the Bering Sea to come down to this immediate area and actually provide an overwatch. So we have increased our presence and we're out forward deployed, capable and ready to react to any problems that potentially occur.
The fishermen know that we're available, but when they see us flying around the fleet, they kind of jogs their memory that we're right here and we'll be ready to respond to any emergencies that they have over the course of the fishery.
Meanwhile, on the Northwestern, Sig Hansen readies his boat and his crew for the season opener. Carrying on the family legacy, Sig is joined by his two younger brothers, Norm and Edgar, for this king crab season. On deck, the brothers and the rest of the crew have spent the last 24 hours prepping bait, grinding 55-pound blocks of frozen herring and stringing up hundreds of cod.
Got another 100 setups to make for the pots, bait setups. Cut the mouths, cut the gill hair, open them up. You cut the stomach, cut the back, so you get the blood out. These fish aren't bled yet. When they're done with filling these bags with herring, we'll end up taking this hook and they're running it through. That'll go right in the middle of the box. Crab are attracted to the herring that they're chopping up. Oil content for the herring, the blood. And the codfish is more of a retainer. Once they're in the pot, then they like to chew on the codfish. Love waking up in the morning and cutting rotten codfish. Nothing better.
Before the season opens, Edgar partakes in an old Norwegian tradition.
Somebody has to bite the head off for good.
have, looks like 5-6 minutes left. Guys are jockeying around in position the way it looks, but I'm surprised there's not more boats in this area.
The one thing about king crab is they're so elusive. It's like you think you got them figured out, and then you slam all your gear in the area and they're gone.
The Bering Sea is the breeding ground for the world's largest population of king crab because of a shallow continental shelf that extends westward from the coast of Alaska and drops off sharply into deeper waters. Nutrients swirl up from the deep Aleutian Basin and create an abundance of sea life at the shelf's edge. Here, huge schools of king crab thrive in complete darkness at about 300 feet, in water as cold as liquid ice.
You don't know if they're stationary or if they're cruising half the time. At least I don't. I haven't figured it out yet. That's what makes it interesting. You never know.
The start of the crab season is only minutes away. Reputations are on the line, and livelihoods are at stake. After weeks of preparation and a year of planning, at 4 p.m. on October 15th, the first pot goes in. Laying the pots in strings covering different depths and locations, captains can only hope to hit the mother load by landing them along a huge school of large male king crab. But crab fishing is always hit or miss.
These boats in the radar are 6 miles from us. They're way up to the east, southeast of us. See that? Got me interested in why. Keep thinking they know something I don't.
While there are no guarantees fishing the Bering Sea, one thing is for certain. Weather can change in an instant. 50 miles to the south, the Sea Star is taking the brunt of rising seas.
Current and you get a wave, like right now we have a 12-footer right now. If it was blowing much harder, we would have to slow down a little bit to keep from, you know, bearing a bow or bearing a boat into the ocean or into the sea. See, if the wind has been slowly building, it'll build the seas. It's a sea state that would determine whether we fish or not. It's not the amount of wind, it's how the wind has built up the sea state. What was that? Get our anchor. We're losing our anchor. Go stop the break there.
A loose anchor could rip a huge hole in the boat's hull.
Would you? The anchor winch is letting loose here from the weather. Get the hydraulics. We need help right now. This is a dangerous situation. This worries me right now that I have 4 men out here and I'm slowly having to head into the sea. A roll blade could come and I just have to make sure that they're watching out for what's going on. This is what I'm talking about.
Hey, man, be careful there, Brian.
Heads up. That one's coming. Get on it.
Mother Nature shows no mercy if you decide to buck her.
While the Sea Star has narrowly avoided disaster, another boat won't be so lucky.
Okay, Kodiak, this is the Raven. We're laying way over on our side. Everybody's got our survival suits on. There's 5 people on the boat. Repeat, 5 people. Okay, Kodiak, this is the Raven. We're laying way over on our side. Everybody's got our survival suits on. There's 5 people on the boat. Repeat, 5 people.
This is Coast Guard Cutter We copy that mayday. We are currently launching our kilo. We're approximately 13 miles from that position. Over.
There's a boat gave a mayday. They're trying to establish position and vessels in the area to see who's the closest that could possibly go save the crew or help the vessel.
Kodiak, windward.
He's listing. He's rolling over. He had a 25-degree list. They've lost contact with him now. No vessels in the immediate vicinity.
Position was 55.55.28 north, 162.46.31.
He's 13, 14 miles below me. Let's see if there's someone close to him here. He's got a starboard list, so he's probably, I don't know, maybe he's taking on water somewhere, or a tank is probably flooded somewhere. If he was closer to me, we'd have to go get him. I mean, that's all there is to it.
I haven't heard any communication from him for at least 5 minutes here, okay?
While the Northwestern listens helplessly to the disaster unfold, the Coast Guard chopper on patrol 50 miles to the south is responding to the mayday. The pilot radios all information to the cutter Morgenthau.
6012, cutter Morgenthau. We're on 4125, no other comms. We're talking with another vessel.
As the pilots approach the Raven, they quickly realize that the boat is in serious trouble.
The Raven is not.
With most of its pot still on board, the top-heavy Raven is in serious danger of rolling over and sinking. This can happen in minutes, sucking the crew down with it.
Okay, these will be basket recoveries of these guys in their survival suits. So they're getting ready to go. They got to get off of there. That last roll they took was pretty nasty.
Are we going to get them off the boat with the basket?
We're just going to take them right off the boat. Just get the basket ready.
Roger.
The big unknown for the Coast Guard is if any of the fishermen will panic or get caught in the rigging. As the first man reaches the cabin, the Coast Guard's fears are realized when he makes a dangerous mistake.
He's trying to climb in, don't grab him.
He grabs for the rescuer's leg and tries to pull himself out of the basket.
Stay in the basket!
The basket must be brought inside the cabin so the fishermen can safely get out. With one crew member in the chopper, the situation is still urgent for the men below. One rogue wave could wash the crew overboard or take the boat to the bottom. True to procedure and tradition, the captain is the last man to leave the boat.
Before you do that, ask them to make sure that they just had five people on board.
Best
For the crew of the Raven, the season is over before it even started. These men will get off the chopper broke, but alive. They are among the fortunate who have survived a sinking ship on the Bering Sea.
It's good to see everybody get off safe and without getting hurt or tangled up or something like that. It was good seeing that. It was a good feeling for me to get in it, kind of good and bad. I didn't really want to leave the boat because I wasn't sure what it was going to do. Kind of sad watching the boat sitting there like that and leaving it and abandoning it, but just relief more than anything in kind of a daze, you know.
The cutter's on scene with it right now. It's going to be up to the district commander to decide what to do in relation to the vessel. Obviously, it's floating out there. It's unmanned, so it's a hazard to navigation right now.
Don't know quite what to think about the whole thing, so it was a relief to see the guys get off, see everybody get off safe and sound, because a lot of times it doesn't work quite that way.
Raven was fortunate enough that we happened to be on patrol. It really feels good to get out there and do our job, and you know, we got five guys that are talking to their wives on the telephone right now saying, I'm all right, honey, I'll be home in a day or two. So that really is why we're all out here. And it makes me feel real proud to do what we're doing right now.
Back on the Northwestern, Sig has followed the events as he continues laying pots.
I'm just glad to get the pots off the deck. Especially after hearing about the Raven, it doesn't really... Now, it is a little spooky.
It's been a trying first day for the crews, but they still face many more days of punishing weather, deadly pots, and non-stop work. Fatigue will soon set in and dramatically increase the odds of something else going terribly wrong. But these are the dangers Alaskan crab fishermen are willing to face for a shot at big money. Tomorrow, they will pull up their first pots and their fortune will be revealed. But right now, their fortune is crawling on the ocean floor. On day one of the king crab season, the fleet battled fierce wind and waves, and the Bering Sea already claimed a ship. But on day two, the work must go on for the remaining 251 boats. Over the last 35 hours, the crew of the Erla N has prepped, baited, and dumped most of their 200 pots. On the deck of a Bering Sea crab boat, the relentless task of baiting goes to the greenhorns.
Working my ass off. So my feet are a little tired because my feet are wet. Socks are wet. But I can guarantee I'm retiring after this.
Our boy Levi here has been up for what? 35 maybe?
More hours than he's ever been in his whole life.
Can you smell that?
It's burning denim.
He is forgetting where he is, what the bait is. The pods have doors. I mean, it's getting, we're about ready to put him to bed here in about less than half an hour or so.
No, hour and a half.
Oh, hour and a
no,
half.
No, he's bumming for another hour and a half.
We're going to try to keep him alive. Here, Levi. Levi. Come here, bud. He doesn't even want to talk to us. Levi, come here. We want to talk to you.
God bless him, you know, he's doing such a good job. The boy is in his own world right now.
I think I'm doing pretty well, you know. The guys happen to give me a few comments, you know, today that I'm trying to keep up, you know, and hustling. So the last 20 pots or so, it's just been one after another, and I've been having to take a leak now for about the last hour and a half, 2 hours, so.
With many pots still on board, and before even a single crab hits the deck, disaster strikes the Erla N.
Oil, we have the oil cooler on the twin desk. It's like there's a small crack. We got a problem here. Hey! Don't think we gotta shut the bank down!
I'm just standing by to see what's going on here. Here comes a message.
Hey, man.
Yeah.
We have to shut down the main.
Shut it down?
Okay.
As far as I know, there's some oil coming out of an oil cooler off the reduction gear, and that's about all I know right now. Let me go look at it.
The oil cooler is cracked, which means the engine will overheat if it's run at full power. A 150 miles at sea and without a replacement, the engineer's only option is to try and weld or braze the crack shut.
Well, I'm drifting right now. I shut everything down. If I keep the RPMs down on the engine, is that one of the main things? Hey, Scott, thanks a lot. We're gonna give it a try. I'll let you know what happened. Let's go ahead and do plan A.
Bypass it.
Connect them real good. You stay down there, get it off, get it to the bench. You gotta get a lot of that oil out of there in order to raise it.
The engine is running at a third capacity. Bing is now severely handicapped in his hunt for crab. He can no longer move the pots around. With such a short season, the situation on the Erla N is dire.
We're losing time. Yeah. Losing valuable time, but whatever the problem is, I hope they got it fixed so that we can make it through the rest of the season at least.
A lot of these guys around here, they probably already got crab aboard. We haven't even hauled the pot yet. We're still trying to get the rest of ours out, so.
50 miles to the north, the Northwestern approaches the first crab buoy and prepares to haul the first pot.
Anybody else have butterflies?
So bad, you would not believe it.
The object of it is don't miss.
I'm gonna be on the hook.
Oh my God. Bad luck. All the, if he misses, bad luck.
All the pressure's right here.
Hooking the buoy line is one of the most difficult jobs on deck.
I haven't thrown the hook in 2 years. Know if I can throw it.
While the boat is moving, the deckhand must hook a buoy line up to 20 feet away. If he misses, the boat must turn around, a waste of time and money. The pot has been soaking on the ocean floor for 12 hours. With such a short season, a full pot will put the Northwestern well ahead of the game. An empty one will send them scrambling.
That's money. There's your money shot.
That is good.
For the crew of the Northwestern, their high seas gamble has paid off. They have hit the mother lode. As they sort through the pile, they're searching for Bering Sea gold, large male king crabs. Females and juveniles are returned to the sea while the males are placed in holding tanks. Here, they will be kept alive until they are processed back in Dutch Harbor. At this pace, the crew could easily fill the tank, earning the boat $500,000. 50 miles to the south, the Sea Star is striking out.
I assume this last pot was zero. It's our first zero for the season.
Damn it! So now we do the cod toss. I don't know, boy, there's some serious tides that are actually affecting the crab so bad. It's minus tides, you're yanking them so much. So the crabs dig into the bottom. They don't want to go in the pots.
The current flows from the southwest up to the northeast, or from the northeast to the southwest. And so these are the
situation, or these are the conditions where you can have dangerous seas with opposing tide or current against the wind, which stacks the seas up and makes it not impossible, but miserable to stand up and work in. I got that, and then Kenny was going to make some comments.
Having struck out at this spot, the crew starts pulling and stacking all the pots in hopes of finding a better one nearby. With the rough seas, the task soon turns into a deadly waltz.
You're going to get away from the pot, you guys! Stay away! Come on. Yeehaw! Let me bring it back this way a little bit.
Finally, with all the pots stacked and secured, Norman drops his guard for an instant at the rail. But an instant is all the Bering Sea needs to kill.
You all right?
Yeah. Well, the first thing you do is start counting bodies. It happened a year or so ago. Something like that happened. A guy got washed out the overboard. They never found him again.
I got hit by a big wave, came over the rail, knocked me on my feet, and knocked me on my butt. And I ended up underneath the sort table. I gotta get out of my wet clothes because they're awful wet.
In this business, every crew member has taken to memory the list of the world's deadliest jobs.
There's us, there's coal miners, there's refinery workers, and then loggers are the top four.
After a quick change of clothes, Norm is right back on the rail. This time, he has escaped becoming a grim statistic that keeps crab fishing at the top of that list.
Watch your three-way coming.
But this is only day two of the fishing season. The relentless schedule and brutal conditions will continue taking its toll on these men. They will have to dig deep to survive three more days of the deadliest job on Earth. It's early morning on day three of the king crab season. And according to the fish and game estimates, the fleet has caught half of the 14 million pound quota. At this pace, they estimate the season will close in 2.5 more days. Crab fishing is always hit or miss, and the catch will vary from boat to boat. The Northwestern has scored big numbers.
58.
While the Erla N has been scraping by.
505.
They have been unable to fix their cracked oil cooler, limiting their movement, and they are left to scavenge in an area to the southeast that's already been fished out. The situation is desperate until a boat on its way north offers a ray of hope.
We just haven't had an oil cooler on board, a spare one that we needed. It's the way these guys are out here. You need something that always take the time to help you out. They'd want you to do it for them.
We'll go up behind the Kiska Sea and he'll tie that oil cooler to a set of buoys. And then trail them behind the boat and we'll pick them up just like picking up crab pot buoys. And hopefully it'll be the oil cooler we need.
Let's get it inside now.
Even though they are competing for the same crab, at the end of the day, the Bering Sea Fishing Fleet is a family that takes care of its own.
Yeah, that's great. Thanks a lot.
As Lance descends into the engine room, the crew's fortune rests in his hands. But they are in luck. The oil cooler fits, and the Erla N is finally back in business. With an estimated 2.5 days left in the season, the pressure's on.
Get moving out there.
If life on deck was miserable before, it will soon become a living hell.
Get bait now. Let's get into this pot, okay?
Big guy, get that bait in that pot now.
He's in a hurry.
I hope the second part of this season goes better than the first part of this season.
As the sun sets on another day, 50 miles to the north, the Sea Star is still striking out.
Trying to get back in the groove with only 3 hours of sleep, and it ain't easy. Lots of coffee. Some nice big crab would be a motivation, though.
The crew's livelihood hangs in the balance with every empty pot.
That didn't look all that good. It wasn't that many crabs. This first one, let's see what happens when it comes over the rail. No, there's not many there at all.
The crew works through the night. But day four dawns to more empty pots, and the situation is desperate.
505.
Oh, I'm just looking for the some old fishing grounds from back in the 70s.
With 2 days left, Larry has time for only one last shot at saving the season.
I'm gonna run westward. Take a gamble. Go where no boats have gone in years. Years ago, we used to fish west during the heydays. And what's happened here is we have had such a short period of time to search these crab out that no one's willing to take a risk and run off to somewhere where there hadn't been crabs in years. But I have a sneaking suspicion myself that the crab are west, more westerly and more northerly than most people suspect. And I think we can pull off some type of an average season. It only takes 100 pots and 100 average, and you have a season made, and that can be done in just less than 12 hours.
For the crews of the Sea Star and the Erla N, the final 48 hours of the king crab season will offer a last chance at redemption. So far this season, they and the rest of the crews have been relatively lucky. No lives have been lost. But as the Crab Derby enters its final frantic stage, tragedy will strike for the men aboard the Sea Star.
I'm on 64. Hey, look for Shaman Kenny.
I'll do it.
A mayday comes in from their partner boat, the Shaman.
Get up high and keep a good eye. Just get a couple men up the top looking there. He had two men over the side. He had one man go over. He sent another man over in a survival suit. There's two men in the water now. One's unaccounted for.
He's not too far away, so we're gonna go look.
The man overboard turns out to be Terry Rosendahl, a former crew member of the Sea Star.
He's cooked aboard here many years. Him and I have always been good friends, and it just doesn't look good for him.
After several tense minutes, the silhouette of the Shaman finally appears on the horizon.
Yeah, get those, where's those smokes? Where's those smokes?
I got him here, Larry.
Here's the perfect time to release him. Now.
The situation is critical because Terry has been lost in near freezing water for 10 minutes without a survival suit.
And he's a close friend of mine. He's worked for me for years. Come on, Terry.